watching Amazing Fire TV. Amazing Fire TV. Impacting the world for Christ.
Magnified, O Lord, forever and ever be thou magnified. We glorify you, Lord, for you are a great King, the Ancient of Days that does not change. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you today. We call upon you to come and be in our midst as we have come. Let your presence be here with us. Speak that we shall hear. Minister unto us this morning that we shall be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, beloved people all over the globe, all over the city of Houston, we have come again this morning. We have come today to come and share with us the word of God. And we pray that your ears shall be open to hear. We know it's not about hearing. It's about hearing and understanding. When you hear, you don't understand, it's a problem. We pray that you hear today and understand. Today we have come with a message titled, What is Your Pursuit? This has been a burden for a short period of time now to know exactly what your pursuit is. It is important you begin to assess yourself, you begin to examine yourself and know your pursuit. Your pursuit defines who you are. It talks about you. We want you to please pay attention to what your pursuit is. When you're talking about what your pursuit is, we are talking about what are you securing. There is a goal you have. There is something you're trying to secure. What is it all about? But no matter what it is, we don't want you to be ignorant of the Word of God. That is why we are here, that you will be filled with the Word of God, that you will be filled with the knowledge of the Father, to the point that you will not deceive yourself nor deceive another. Amen. At a certain place in the scripture, Jesus himself began to minister to the people, talking about prayer, teaching them, equipping them, that they will be able to stand even in the days of adversaries. In the time of adversity, that they will be able to stand firm without any fear. You know, the Bible says he has not given us the spirit of fear. So he has been able to equip his people. And he said to them, according to somewhere in Matthew chapter number 6, he began to tell them, well, when they pray, let their prayer be based on this reality. Thy kingdom come. Jesus was talking about the kingdom. Whose kingdom was he talking about? Not the kingdom of man. Not the kingdom of heaven, but the kingdom of God. I know most times I've been able to misinterpret the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. However, we have not come to lay emphasis on the two, but yet there is such a thing called the kingdom of heaven, and there is such a thing called the kingdom of God. But let it not be a problem. But today, I want to bring to our understanding that a certain place in Matthew, Jesus began to teach the people. And his concern was to teach them how to pray. And the prayer was in this dimension. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That was a concern of Jesus. That was the burden in his heart. And he was able to teach the people so, to pray thy kingdom come. What are we talking about? Today we are talking about what is your pursuit, as the title of the message is. What is your pursuit? Is your pursuit based on what you see on a daily basis? You say, I'm going to pursue this today. Remember, when you are led by what you see today, tomorrow you will see another thing. Then you deviate again to that thing. Next tomorrow you see another thing, you deviate. But it is possible that a man should have a pursuit and should be able to do what? To move by his pursuit all day long without dangling from one place to the other, without, you know, moving like the wind. So I want to bring to us this message today, to the point that we'll be satisfied, to the point that we'll be able to capture it and come to the reality of what the message of God is all about. I want us to go to the scripture, the book of Matthew, chapter number 6, verses number 33. In the book of Matthew, chapter number 6, verses number 33, it reads, But seek ye first the kingdom of God. This is Jesus talking to the people. And he began to instruct them. He began to direct them. He began to speak unto them. He began to minister unto them in this capacity. But seek ye first the kingdom of God. It did not end there. He also said, and his righteousness. That is to say, there is such a thing called the kingdom of God. There is such a thing called his righteousness. We talk about our righteousness. No, I'm not talking about your righteousness, because your righteousness will disappoint you in a very short period of time. But this part of the scripture is talking about his righteousness. The first one, the kingdom of God, one. The second one, his righteousness. Now, based on these two capacities, the Bible said, and all these things shall be added unto you. That is to say, there is a possibility that all things can be added unto a man, but it depends on how you start. It depends on your focus. It depends on your pursuit. And Jesus is making us understand that it is possible for a man to have pursuit, even though you do not have pursuit for today. That has not been defined by you. God is today giving you a pursuit. And he said it is in this dimension. Number one, seek ye first the kingdom of God. I want us to talk about the kingdom of God before we go into his righteousness and talk about, and all these things shall be added unto you. Most of us today, we are pushing what? All the things that should have been added unto us when we have been able to do what? Fulfill the first law, which is to seek the kingdom of God, and to fulfill the second law, which is his righteousness. Now the question is this: what is the kingdom of God? The Bible, when I keep on reading the Bible and reading, I keep on having understanding. And I know today, as you read with me, God will minister unto you to the point that you will be able to have a defined understanding, an understanding that will lead you through. Now, what is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is the realm where God reigns supreme. And Jesus himself is what is the king. Remember, there is no king without kingdom. Before you talk about kingdom, there is a king. And there is no king that will be talking about king without doing what? Talking about the kingdom. Now, the kingdom of God makes us to understand, in the kingdom of God, we are meant to understand that Jesus himself is the king. What am I talking about? In the book, when you keep on studying the Bible, you'll be able to understand, even according to the language, according to Hebrew language, the kingdom of God is mamalia. What does that mean? It means a realm. That means we are talking about the realm of the kingdom of God, the realm of God, the reality of God, the existence of God, the nature of God. Now the Bible began to do what? To admonish all men to do what? To seek this thing first, the kingdom of God. I don't know what you have been pursuing all these days. Maybe you've been mindful of your own kingdom, trying to establish your own kingdom, trying to do one or two things with the kingdom of men. But Jesus said to us, do what? Seek ye the first, the kingdom of God. Like I said, in Hebrew language, the kingdom is known to be what? Mamalia. So what are we talking about? It is possible for a man to go after the kingdom of God. It is possible that from now henceforth, your pursuit will be what? All about the kingdom of God, not the kingdom of men. There is such a thing called the kingdom of men. There is such a thing called what? The kingdom of heaven. But I'm talking about the kingdom of God, wherein God reigns what? Supreme. And Jesus himself is what? Is the king. And I'm telling you, this kingdom is the thing that have come to stay. It will never be what? It will never be taken out of the land of the living. It is a reality. And when you begin to seek this kingdom of God, I bet you, you begin to move to the point you begin to have knowledge about the things of God. You begin to move in the things of God. Remember, the Bible said a certain place in the book of John chapter number 4, he said that God is a spirit, and those that worship him most certainly worship him in two dimensions. Number one, they worship him in truth. Number two, they worship him in the spirit. If we're talking about the truth, remember Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If we're talking about worshiping God in truth, there is no how you can worship God in truth and do what? Ignore the message of Jesus Christ. And do what? And pretend never to know Jesus Christ. And disagree that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. Are we together this morning? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. We're going to be studying the book of Acts of the Apostles right now, chapter number 20. I want us to examine the man called Apostle Paul. According to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 20, I want us to read verses number 19 first. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20, verses 19, this is Paul now. He said, serving the Lord with all humility of mind. This is a man that is concerned about the kingdom of God. And he said, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, not with 99% humility of mind, rather with all, and with many tears. Look at the experience of Paul in his days, because he was what? Seeking the kingdom of God. While he was seeking it, he was able to pass through things that was able to allow him to do what? Have tears. That is to say, it was not easy. It was not as though it was a simple thing. No, he did what? He did it with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. Why this man called Apostle Paul was busy with the kingdom of God, like the Bible says, seek it first. This man was able to experience and observe that even there were a people, they were lying in wait against him, which were addressed as the Jews. The Jews at that material, the Jews at that material time, they were against Apostle Paul. But not minding that they were against him, he wasn't able to do what? To proceed. He never allowed what he heard or what he saw or what he knew about the adversity of the people, about the wickedness of the people. He never allowed all those things to do what? To subdue him. He never allowed those things to do what? To conquer him. But he was able to proceed. And the Bible said that he was able to proceed and he had many tears. And I want to tell you, even within the midst of those tears, Paul was able to proceed. He was able to continue. Why? He was determined in what? In seeking first the kingdom of God. If you're not determined in seeking first the kingdom of God, time will come when you will easily do what? You will backslide. Because of what? You have not been able to understand the kingdom of God. When you understand the kingdom of God, it will allow you to do what? To be able to become more humble. The Bible says, serving the Lord with all humility of mind. How many of you have been able to serve God with all humility of mind? Some of us today, we begin to serve because of one talent or the other. We say, oh my God, I'm not going to take this. But in the days of Apostle Paul, he took it all and he was grateful to God that he did. Let's continue reading that first chapter. Let's go to verses number 22. In the same Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20, verses number 22, as we begin to read. And it says, and now, behold, I go back in the spirit unto Jerusalem. This was Paul addressing the people. He was telling them the reality at that material time, that it was the spirit of God that was leading him. And he was able to speak out. He said, I go bound in the spirit unto Jerusalem. This was the Jerusalem that a man called Prophet Agabus was able to minister unto him, telling the people that he saw when he went to where Paul left his garment. He took the garment and was able to tie his hands. And he said that in this same dimension, in this same way, with the owner of this thing be tied in Jerusalem. He was able to tell the truth, and this was actually the truth. And Paul himself was not there. When Paul came back, the people began to tell Paul, look at the prophecy. Look at what the prophet said, that he will be what? He will be imprisoned. He will suffer in the land of Jerusalem. This is what happened in Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 21. He made them to understand, oh, it does not matter. I don't mind. Even though I be bound, I don't mind. I will go beyond that. I don't care if there is death. If death will strike, I do not care. Why? Paul was determined in what? In seeking first the kingdom of God. And as long as he was determined in that, there was nothing that would have caused him to do what? To derail. Nothing was able to make his spirit become cold because of what? He knew the importance of seeking the kingdom of God. Beloved, I want to tell you today, if you say you're seeking the kingdom of God, there should be nothing that will allow you to do what? To go astray. When things come to run you down, when things come to challenge you such a way that you will say what? That you're not going to continue. Yes, they will certainly come. But remember, God said, I have not given you the spirit of fear, but I've given what? The spirit of boldness. With boldness, you will be able to do what? You will proceed. You will conquer. You will do what? You will overcome men. You will overcome spirits. Why? Because of the spirit of God. Remember a certain place in Romans, he said, that if the spirit of God begins to lead you, that there is nothing you will not overcome. And he said it in this dimension. Blessed as many as are led by the spirit of God, they are the sons of God. I tell you, the sons of God can never be conquered by any man, by any spirit. Even by the princes of this world, they can never conquer them. Because of what? You have been led by the spirit of the living God. And that was the thing that was leading Paul and made him to say in Acts of the Apostles chapter number 20, from verses number 22, he said that I go bound in the spirit unto Jerusalem. Not because of his intentions, not because he wanted to do it to show off, but in the spirit, he go back unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, not knowing the things that shall befall him there, but what he knows that he will certainly go, save that the Holy Ghost witnessed in every city, saying that bounds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me. None of these things did what? Move them. Why? He was concerned about what? About the kingdom of God. About the kingdom of God. About his righteousness. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Beloved, I want to ask you a question. In your pursuit today, what is it all about? Is it about the kingdom of God? If it be about the kingdom of God, I tell you, no matter the challenges, you will do what? You will excel. No matter the problems, you do what? You will overcome. No matter the obstacle, no matter the mountains, you will do what? You will be able to do what? You will be able to stand strong. You will never faint. Why? Because of what? It is the command of God. It is what? The teaching of the Father that we should henceforth begin to seek first the kingdom of God. But most of us today are not seeking this kingdom. But in the days of Apostle Paul, he began. When he began, he continued. When he continued, he got to the end of it that he was able to say a certain time in the Acts of the Apostles that when he was a child, he spoke as a child. What are you speaking as? Are you still speaking as a child? When you see yourself speaking as a child, begin to pray that you grow. Paul was able to attest to this reality that there was a time in his life that he did not grow. Even in those days, he was able to persecute Christians. That was with his own understanding. That was by his own knowledge. He saw it to be a burden for a people that are called Christians to exist. Now he stood against them and he began to resist them. He began to deal with them. But the time came in his life that he was able to address those his actions as though he was even was acting as a little child. But the Bible has it that sometime came that he was able to grow. That he was able to grow. I pray and I pray to God Almighty that you even today that's hearing this message, that you will grow. May you grow in the name of Jesus. May you grow in the name of Jesus. If Paul was able to grow, you will grow in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's talk about the righteousness of God. I just want to say this in bits that we may be able to capture it all. I'm going to somewhere. I want us to arrive at the same time and so that we'll be able to say what? That God is faithful. Let's talk about his righteousness. Now, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What is the righteousness of God? If you begin to study the scripture, you'll be able to understand that this righteousness of God is not the righteousness of man. And it is not. It has nothing to do with the righteousness of men. And the righteousness of God is this. This is the state of what? Moral perfection required by God to the point that you can do what? You will be able to make heaven. Remember what Paul said. He said, if only in this earth, in this life, we have hope, we are of all men what? Miserable. That is to tell you that our hope is beyond this earth realm. Why? There is a place we can do what? We can find ourselves. If you are able to align to the word of God, Jesus said that he's going to do what? He's going to the Father and he will be seated what? At the right hand of God. When the apostles met Jesus Christ and began to ask him questions, they told him, Master, we have forsaken wives, we have forsaken properties, we have forsaken the land, we have left this and that only to follow you. What is our what? What is our reward? What is our profit? I want to tell you, before you begin to talk about what to profit from God, begin to ask yourself, what have you let go? What have you been able to let go? There should be things you have been able to do what? To let go. There are things you must certainly let go. Otherwise, you may not be able to do what? To run this race. You may not be able to do what? To have this proper pursuit that is what expected of all men. When this person was asked Jesus Christ, he looked at his disciples and he smiled and said unto them, in the regeneration to come, in time to come, you all will do what? Sit with me at the right side of my what? Of my Father. And you will sit on the throne, judging the what? The 12 tribes of who? Of Israel. That there is a place that they will be able to do what? To see themselves. Do not think that this pursuit we're talking about is going to make you to waste your time here on earth. No, you are not going to waste your time. But it's going to do what? Allow you to align to the will of the Father. It will allow you to do what? Align to the purpose of the Father. It will allow you to be with Jesus where he is. Because in that place is a very decent place, is a good place, and it's a place you should not do what? Miss. For you not to miss there, what are you gonna do? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What is righteousness? The word righteousness in Hebrew is what? Has data. That is in Hebrew. Has data. The word righteousness. Now, let me talk about it in English. Let's understand it. It's one in the right word. In the right. One in the right. You can also say it to be what? To be justice. It can be what? Also addressed to be what? Innocent. Let's go to the book of John chapter number 14 verses number 30. The word righteousness is innocent, to be innocent. In John chapter 14 verses number 30, I read, hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh. Jesus was speaking, addressing his people. The prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. This is what? Innocent. The prince of the world cometh and he hath nothing in him. I want to tell you that in righteousness, Jesus was found there. And he was able to address his disciples. And he said unto them, hereafter, I will not talk much with you. I will not talk much with you. For the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. I want to tell you, in the days of Adam, the prince of the world went to Adam through Eve. And he was able to do what? Minister to Eve. And Eve was able to minister to Adam. And that was how that generation was what? Was able to rebel. Was able to go astray. Because of what? When Satan was able to minister, they accepted it. But in the time of Jesus, remember, Jesus is the second Adam. In the time of Jesus, he said, he knows the prince of the world cometh and hath nothing in me. That is to remind what happened in the book of Matthew, chapter number 4. When Jesus, he said that himself, was able to approach Jesus, he approached him in three different dimensions. He told him what? Bow before me, he will do this. Turn this stone to be bread that you will eat. He showed him the things of the world. He was able to do what? To meet Jesus. And he ministered. And all the ministration that the devil was able to render to Jesus, all those things Jesus never fail for any. He was able at the end of the day to do so what? Get thee behind me. That was what he told Satan. So at that material time, the devil departed and was able to go to Jesus again through the servant called Peter. And when Peter was able to begin to speak to Jesus, because Jesus made them to understand that the time has come for him to depart from this earth realm, Peter began to minister to him, and he was able to discuss this in the book of John, chapter number 16, verses number 23. Peter was able to tell Jesus, oh, do not do this. Why? Because Jesus made them to understand that it was important that he will die, and he will do what? He will be buried, but finally he will resurrect and go back to the Father. Now Peter was not able to do what? Was not able to accept this, was not able to understand it. He couldn't bear it. He could not do what? He could not understand it. And the Bible reads there, and in that day ye shall ask me nothing. Very, very, I say unto you, whatever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. This was what Jesus told them, making them to understand that even if he departs, whatever you ask the Father in his name, he will do what? He will still give it to who? To them. Now, I was talking about Jesus when he was able to speak to Peter in that dimension. He said to Peter, what? Get thee behind me. Why? Because Satan wanted to meet with Jesus through Peter. He allowed Peter to tell Jesus, don't allow this to happen. But Jesus heard the word and never accepted it. That was why Jesus was able to tell the people, see, the spirits of this world cometh to me, but he find nothing in me. Because he will find nothing in me, the same way he came, the same way he will do what? He will depart. This is God, Jesus, being innocent. You can be innocent. That was why Jesus came, that he will teach you the way, the truth, and the life. Because when you believe in him, you will never do what? You will never regret it. When you go to the book of Matthew, chapter number 3, from verses number 13. That is the scripture that was able to address righteousness again. This was in the time of Jesus Christ. Let me read the scripture, the book of Matthew, chapter 3, from 13 to 15. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbid him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and cometh thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now. Jesus responded, suffer it to be so. Beloved, I don't know what you are passing through, but there are things you must certainly need to do what? Suffer to be so. There are things you will certainly need to suffer to be so. What are those things? Those things that call for what? For righteousness. You must suffer it to be so, that you will do what? You will be able to excel in righteousness. For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. Jesus went to be baptized. And when John the Baptist was able to see Jesus, he said, no, how can me, a little boy, a boy of yesterday, be stand to do what? Baptize the master? He said, no, I need to be baptized of Jesus Christ. Jesus heard him. And when Jesus heard what John the Baptist said, he didn't say, oh, okay, get in there, let me baptize him. But Jesus said, no, suffer it to be so. Why? There is need for us to do what? Fulfill all righteousness. Beloved, I'm telling you what, that the kingdom of God is a need, and what? The righteousness of God is a calling that we have to do what? We have to pursue. Begin to pursue the kingdom of God and his righteousness. In the days of Jesus, he was able to pursue this. And John the Baptist said unto him, no, master, I should not be the one to baptize you. But Jesus said, no, suffer it to be so, that it will become what? Us to fulfill all righteousness. Beloved child of God, beloved listener, how many times have you been able to fulfill the righteousness of God? It is a calling. It is a mandate. It should be a pursuit to fulfill all righteousness. It should be a pursuit to pursue the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Suffer it to be so. Jesus knew that it was right to suffer it to be so, and he will never allow the spoken word of John the Baptist to make him to do what? To derail. I don't know what I've heard in the time past in the ministry. They may have told you, hey, you are the master, do not do this. But I've come to remind you, there are things in this earth realm that we must have to do what? Suffer to be so. So that we do what? We fulfill all righteousness. You are called to fulfill all righteousness. In the days of Jesus, he fulfilled all righteousness, and it was counted unto him. If you fulfill righteousness, it will also be counted unto you. I want us to go to the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 3, from verses number 8. Father, we thank you. We bless your name. The book of 1 Kings, chapter number 3, from verses number 8. This is the time of Solomon. Let's just read it and we shall be blessed. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, which thou hast chosen. Remember, this is Solomon. When he was made a king, he knew he has been given what? He has been given a great assignment. In his own strength, he will not be able to get it right. So he was able to ask of the Lord. And he said, a great people that cannot be numbered nor counted for multitude. This was Solomon, a king. Remember the birth of Solomon and how he was able to emerge. Solomon was the son of David. And he was able to emerge after the tug of war. When he was able to emerge, he was concerned about the people. This is a man being concerned about the kingdom of God. This is a man being concerned about all righteousness. So in that capacity, he knew that the only possibility can be accessed through God. The only possibility is locked up in God. So he was able to do what? He was able to encounter the Lord. And when he encountered the Lord, he was able to begin to make a request, because God gave him an opportunity to do what? To make a request. And his request was in this dimension. Oh my God, I have received an assignment. I am now a king, but Jehovah, I need you to do what? I need you to give me an understanding that I will be able to do what? To lead these people not astray, but to lead them aright. And when God was able to hear the heart cry of the man called King Solomon, God was surprised. God was like, wow, oh my son Solomon, did you make such a request? Because of this request, I will do more for you. Because of this request, I will grant you more than you have been able to ask. I want to tell you, when a man begins to pursue the kingdom of God, when you begin to pursue all righteousness, I tell you, you can ascertain it. And because you are eager, because I begin to pursue it, and because you have pursued it, I tell you, every other thing shall be added unto you. Just like in the days of Solomon, where he made this request, because his concern was the kingdom of God, his concern was all righteousness, God said unto him, if you keep reading verses number 9, verse number 9 to number 10 of the same first Kings of the number 3. If you proceed from 9 to 10, you'll be able to understand that God was surprised. And he said unto him, I will give you beyond what you have been able to ask. Beloved listener, wherever you are, I've come to tell you that there's a thing that magnets every other thing. There is a possibility that what you never knew you needed, you can achieve it without pursuing it. There are things that God can do what? Can do what? Give unto you as a grant. Just take. I can give unto you what? As stipend. Just take. I can use to do what? To settle you. When the man called Solomon was able to request it, God said, no, my son, I will give you beyond this. I will give you. Why? He was concerned about the kingdom of God. He was concerned about righteousness. He needed understanding that he will be able to do what? To proceed. And in verse number 10 of that first Kings chapter number 3, and the speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. The speech pleased the Lord. Beloved, you can please God. And when God is pleased with a man, when God is pleased with a man, he begins to reveal himself. He begins to fill the man with joy, with the thing that he needs here on earth to live as a man in the earth realm. The Bible said that the meek will do what? We inherit the earth. I tell you, begin to pursue the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Solomon pursued it, and God visited him and said, my son, I will give you riches. I will give you fame. I will give you a name. I will be with you. I will do this. I will do that. And Solomon in his days, he was able to experience the blessings that was found in God. The blessings that no man will be able to give. I tell you, beloved brother, beloved sister, this is the time to begin to pursue. Begin to pursue the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Begin to pursue the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It does not matter. They may have told you that no man is perfect, but I tell you today, the Bible makes us understand. Even in the book of Genesis, the Bible told Abraham, oh, come be perfect. The calling of Abraham was a calling of perfection, that he will perfect. The same calling is upon you, beloved listener. The same calling is upon you. God wants you to be perfect. There are things he wants to release unto you, but he will not be able to release those things until you stand strong. If you're able to stand strong, he will grant unto you your heart desire. And beyond your heart desire, he will reveal his might, he will reveal his love unto you, to the point that you will say, oh, I never knew he will honor you. I tell you today, beloved, Come out from among them. What are you pursuing? Are you pursuing fame, greatness? Come out from among them. Come and begin to pursue the kingdom of God. It is a calling. Pursue righteousness, and every other thing shall be added unto you. Remember, the word of God is yea and amen. He has never lied. His word must surely come to pass. Even though heaven and earth pass away, his word will never pass away. The Bible is calling you this morning to pursue the kingdom. Pursue righteousness, and everything shall be added unto you. May you be blessed this morning as you have heard this word in Jesus' name.
You are now watching Amazing Fire TV.